feeling to the painting and to the writing, the two of the last things that I ever thought I'd ever do. I grew up in North Philadelphia. Went to Bishop Egan High School, went to Temple University, went to Villanova University. And I'm a city kid, North Philadelphia. I didn't go to, was it Holy Ghost private school? I didn't go to any prep school. I started out at Roman Catholic. I don't know if anybody's familiar with Roman Catholic. The Roman Catholic is situated directly over a subway station. And when I was a freshman there, what was in style were double and single half-moon belt buckles. And in order to get your books, you had to have this case. It looked like, back then, a roller skate case with the metal tips on the end. Otherwise, they wouldn't give you the books, right? And you would find out, as soon as you got your books, why you had to have them in that case. So going from one class to another class, if you didn't have them in a case like that, you wouldn't have any books by the time you got to the next class. After school, down to the subway station, up go the boxes, off came the belts, and it was like gladiator school. And last man standing got to go home. And that was about it. Anyway, there was an artist in my family. Actually, my father could draw, and my brother could draw. If he did a portrait, they'd look like a photograph. It was that accurate and that beautiful. If I did a portrait of you, you wouldn't be able to figure out what it was. Right? So I figured, you know, if I spent a whole lot of time, I could maybe do something that sort of looked like something. So I thought, he's the artist, let him do the art, let's be, you know, the kid from North Philadelphia. And so it went that way for years. He could, if he had decided to follow through with it, he could have made a really nice living from it. But he decided, and now people do it, that kind of town, he just stopped. Never did it again. About 12 years ago, I think, I looked at my wife, that's her in the middle there. She gives me all my orders. I said, I think I'm going to paint. And I have no idea. To this day, I have no idea where it came from. It's not like I was reading a magazine, looking at something. So all of a sudden, I just wanted to throw my head. Well, she bought me some paints, and I started out with what do they call it? Canvas boards. Okay. And I played around, and I said, you know what? I'm not going for any classes. I'm not reading any books. I've seen enough paintings, but they're all up in here. And so I started painting. And they were some of the worst paintings you would have ever seen. But eventually, one night, I did this one painting that looked like the silhouette of Miles Davis. And I called her in the room and I said, this actually looks like a painting. You know, I never thought of doing anything that looked like a painting. Well, I kept going, and since then, I had a one-man show. Actually at the Langhorne Coffee House, right up the street. I've had a couple of shows where I've had one or two other pieces, you know, in the show. And it's all way beyond anything that I ever thought would ever happen. So I got a slideshow. Oh! I'm doing this for a few years, and I started out with oil. And I'm using oil and brushes. And then I got to the point where the oil was just too noxious. Terms of the odor, and I kept finding it all over my body as I would paint. And my wife said, "What's wrong with you?" I had no idea. But anyway, I stopped using the oils and I started using acrylics. And it took me a while to get used to the acrylics because they don't have the kind of automatic texture that oils have. And one day I figured out how to get the texture that I wanted. So I went on. And all of a sudden, one day, from out of nowhere, I got this idea instead of using brush strokes, getting a piece of cardboard or metal, like a Venetian blind, slap from Venetian blind, cut that and use the slap from the Venetian blind to scrape across. And I thought I had discovered something. And that's what I've been doing ever since. I've been scraping. Okay? Now, I've done some stuff that I'm really proud of. And I guess about a year ago, I came across a DVD of a guy named Richter. Hey, he's from Germany, and he's one of the most famous artists in the world. And he's been doing this scraping thing forever. So, there goes my big discovery. But his workspace is about at least 10 times the size of my workspace. And because he probably gets paid per painting more than I'll make my whole life from paint. But he's got the equipment that's unbelievable. It, you look at him, you know, that didn't cost $5. And he's got, you know, the stuff that he scrapes with. I just think he probably sits down with all the specs for the craftsman that does this thing. It costs about $5,000 just to, you know, get one piece of equipment. But anyway, let's see. I'm up for the my background there real quick. When I got out of Temple University, I had a degree in teaching, and I actually got a job in teaching, which was really hard because it was at the time of Vietnam. And during Vietnam, school districts weren't hiring people who hadn't been in the service, because they were drafting. And they didn't want to hire somebody and then lose them to the draft. So I went for a lot of interviews before I got the job. After 4 years, I left teaching. I have a problem with authority. And I have a problem with keeping my mouth shut when I think things are not happening the way they should happen. So I was asked to leave.
Yeah.
And I was looking for a job, there were two jobs open at the Bucks County Community College. And my then father-in-law was a township supervisor at Falls Township. And I asked him, because I knew he knew the commissioners, if he could get me an appointment with the commissioners so I could find out if those jobs were really open or were, you know, not worth my time because they were having to fill. So I went up there and then sat down with Joe Catania. I don't know if anybody remembers him. He's probably long gone. But anyway, he called this woman in. And she says, he says, you know, go talk to this guy. And she takes me out of the room and we sit down in the room. And she's talking to me about jobs. And I'm sitting there going, this doesn't sound like the jobs that I'm talking about. And anyway, towards the end of the conversation, it turns out that she's not talking about the jobs that I'm there for. And she's talking about this other thing. Make a long story short, I left the building with a job, with a program. It was called the Employment Training Program. This is back with is Gerald Ford, back when the unemployment rate was higher than it has been in the last recession. Okay. And I wound up working here for 5 years. Wound up eventually being the executive director, and I wound up being like ping pong. Republicans on this side, Democrats on this side, and I didn't have any allies, so it was just back and forth and back and forth. And so finally I said, you know what, I can't take it anymore. So I left. And then I wound up being the director of a veterans outreach center. I was down in Levittown, mainly for Vietnam veterans, but all veterans. And the first 2 years of that job, it was the greatest job I ever had, because we had volunteer lawyers, doctors, you name any professional that a person might be, any kind, they were volunteering at the time. These guys, things were actually happening. People were actually getting help. And then in the third year, like going into it, I thought, who can screw around with this? Who's going to screw around with the veterans? And by the third year that I was there, I found out how the veterans. And, you know, it's like neighborhood turf. You know, I want this, I want that. So they didn't have the center. Our group had the center. And before it was all over, they shut us down. And we were out the street. Okay. Then I worked my dream job, what I thought was a dream. I worked as a manager for a bar down in Center City. And I would tell my customers, I said, I have to go back to the real world. I have no idea what I'm going to do. Yeah. This is just too much, you know, like, because the other employees would talk about the stress. And I would, yeah, no stress. You know, go work my other job. You know, learn about stress. This is, you know, this is fun. This is play. Anyway, I worked there for 13 years. And ironically, the job that I worked after that was as a drug. Basically, what I was doing in the first job was drumming up business for my second. The job after that was as a drug and alcohol addiction Ferber's. So I took all my customers from the bar. Helped them out. Anyway, that turned out to be the most rewarding job I've ever had. Men, women, all ages. And when you could see the light come in your eye, you knew what was happening. And it's like, you can't yell at somebody and make them get well. You know, you can't pamper somebody and make them get well. There's going to be a moment when they get what they call a moment of clarity. It just goes right through the illness, and they know what they have to do. And when you can see that happening to a human being whose life has turned it up, and they've turned everybody else that they know and love into hell, it's just absolutely amazing. And so that was my last job. Retired 2 years ago, or was it 10? About 2 or 3 years ago. And I was going to try to work till 70, but I gave out at 67. And now I just chase my neighbors around with it. Butterfly. So anyway, here is the, here are